So far, up to module 9, we dwelt on the typical sampling designs, starting with the concepts of simple random sampling with and without, which are the very basic sampling designs. And then we talked about stratified sampling with special reference to Neyman's optimal allocation. Then we landed into unequal probability sampling, PPS with and without. And there are various issues related to estimation of the population total, estimation of the variance of the estimate, estimation of population variance, non-negative variance estimation, so on and so forth. So these are all topics in one direction. There has been development in another direction, at least in two other directions, that I would like to touch upon in the next set of modules. So in this module, we are through 7, 8, 9, yeah, in this module, module 10, I want to dwell on a topic which is again very relevant in the context of survey sampling, practically, particularly from the application point of view. So let's see what is coming up now. Subhro, here we take up a topic popularly known as RRT. Randomized response technique. I don't expect you to have any idea about this thing in your undergraduate studies. It's a very special topic, but very, very practically motivated. So I want to take up two special topics, in fact, and discuss some results in the context of finite population inference. Let's see, this topic deals with a situation like this. It is simply stated that a survey statistician chooses an appropriate sampling design based on some considerations and adopts it to arrive at a sample of population units. Next, once the sample units have been identified, investigators or interviewers are sent, and the respondents, they release the desired information in respect of a study character that we have denoted by capital Y. So we denote the typical sample by S, typical units in the sample by I, and therefore data gathered is yi I in s. That's the kind of setup that we are dealing with. Then we proceed to arrive at estimates of the population total ty, estimate of the variance, estimate of the population variance, etc. Though this is very simply stated, in reality it is quite involved, the process of data gathering, at least when the study variable y is not a straightforward thing to perceive. That is what motivated people to think about RRT, or randomized response technique. So there is a concern, and it is of course genuine, among the survey sampling practitioners while dealing with what are called stigmatizing characters. Some examples are incidence of drug use, false statements on income tax return, and so on. Particularly if we want to do a survey among the college students, then the use of drug or alcohol, that is a burning issue. So like that, in every society there are some stigmatizing characters, and to elicit information on such characters becomes problematic, and we don't expect to get truthful response if we go for a direct questionnaire. For such a stigmatizing character may lead to either a refusal or willful tendency to give a wrong answer. It all started in 1965, and as a matter of fact, we are going through the golden jubilee celebration of this technique. So it all started in 1965 on a seminal paper by Warner, and now it is known as randomized response technique. This topic again has been thoroughly researched and documented. There are books, book chapters, chapter coverages in survey sampling books, and there are plenty of research articles by contributors all over.
Sir, it really looks very interesting. I never thought of this, and also never realized that something should be done while addressing such stigmatizing characters. I'm eager to hear all about this, but please start with a very simple motivating example.
Okay, let us talk about estimation of the proportion of drug addicts in a community of adults. We have a well-defined geographical region. We have a listing of all the adults in that listing in that community, we are talking about a finite population of the adults in a certain community, and we want to know what percentage or what proportion of these adults are drug addict. We presumably have a list of all these individuals in the population, so we can take recourse to sampling, for example, simple random sampling without replacement. We decide on a sample size small n, we know the population size capital N. It is very easy to implement this sampling design, and we go about asking them directly about the incidence of the drug addict. What will happen?
Sir, as you said, yes, I understand that it could be a sensitive issue to most sampled respondents, and so we may not expect to receive truthful responses. So, as against direct question technique, Warner suggested something else, right?
He says, to every respondent, you give two cards. One is, these two are marked in two different colors, say black and red. The black card has a statement written at the back, I am a drug addict. The red card, on the other hand, has the complimentary statement written at the back, I am not a drug addict. You also give the respondent a deck of standard cards, black and red. So the idea is that you have a collection of black and red standard cards, as is available for bridge playing, for example, and you have unequal number of black cards than the number of red cards. Maybe you have got 20 black cards and 15 red cards, for example. At the back of every black card, you have the statement written on the top, namely, I am a drug addict. At the back of every red card, you have the statement, I am not a drug addict. You explain to the respondent that he or she is supposed to pick up one card at random from the deck that you are giving and then match the color with that of the black or red card, and then he or she is supposed to truthfully respond to the question written at the back. So let me explain again. There is a master black card having the statement, I am a drug addict, at the back. There is a master red card having the statement, I am not a drug addict, written at the back. These are two master cards before you, and you, as a respondent, you have a number of black and red cards given to you. Is a certain collection of black and red cards. You pick up one card at random. If that card turns out to be black, you refer to the black card and answer truthfully to the question, I am a drug addict. And if the card chosen by you is a red card, you refer to the red master card and then answer to the question, give a truthful answer to the question, I am not a drug addict. You are supposed to explain, so as an investigator, you explain everything to the respondent and then you leave the room, leave everything to the respondent. The respondent understands exactly what he or she is supposed to do, and eventually the answer will be either yes or no, depending on the question that has been picked up and the status of the person involved.
It is definitely interesting and entertaining too. Let me see, if I were the respondent, I would have picked up a card at random from the deck, and if it were red, then as I understand, I would pick up the red card, which reads at the back as, I'm not a drug addict. Yes, I do not mind giving a truthful response to this question, depending on my actual status. If that's all the response required from me, without divulging the color of the card taken from the deck. Am I right, sir?
That is precisely so. The interviewer must make it very clear to the respondent that all he or she is looking for is the final answer, yes or no. Without any other information, that is purely the respondent's confidentiality. And it is believed that by giving so much of confidentiality or privacy to the respondent, we expect truthful response from him or her. Since a card drawing game is involved to pick up the question to be answered, it is referred to as a randomized response technique as against direct response technique.
Sir, where is the assurance that the interviewer will not insist on knowing the color of the card randomly drawn from the deck?
As a matter of fact, in an ideal situation, after explaining all the details of the RRT, this technique, to the respondent, the interviewer is supposed to leave the room and leave the respondent alone to give a fill total privacy attitude to the respondent. We expect this to work.
Okay, I understand and accept the logic for the sake of proceeding further. So from each respondent, we have gathered through randomized response technique a concrete yes or no answer. And hopefully that is a truthful response, no matter whether the question relates to yes or no version of the sensitive character. Finally, we have a total of yes responses, and that's it, right?
Not really. We have something more than that. We know each respondent used the deck of cards and picked up one card at random and checked its color to match with the master black card or master red card for actually answering the relevant question, right? So it was not a purposeful selection of a card from the deck by any respondent for that matter. Let us see how to look at the data now. For this, it is better to develop some useful notations. Imagine there are B black cards and R red cards in the deck given to the respondent. So we do not necessarily consider a full deck of 52 cards with 50-50 split as usual. As a matter of fact, it has got to be different from 50-50 split. So let me explain this point again. So we start with a collection of ordinary deck of cards. So in that collection we put B black and R red cards, but this B and R, they don't have to be 50-50. If not that, we just take a full deck of 52 cards. As a matter of fact, it has got to be different from 50-50. As I said, we may take 20 black and 15 red cards, for example. So let further capital P denote the proportion of drug addicts in the population of capital N individuals. For an individual in the sample, the chance of responding yes, so yes response comes from two phases. Either the person is picking up a black card and the person is a drug addict, thereby says yes, or the person is picking up a red card and the person is not a drug addict, so he is saying yes. Because the red card says, I am not a drug addict. So that is how it can come. So the pi is the sample proportion of yes responses. So this pi, the chance of saying yes, the chance of responding yes is given by P times B over B plus R. B over B plus R is the chance of picking up a black card, and if the person is truly a drug addict, then he will say yes to this question, the chance is P. And the chance is R over B plus R for picking up a red card. The red card reads, I am not a drug addict, and the person has to say no to that answer. Therefore, for that, the answer will be R over B plus R multiplied by 1 minus P. From that, we can solve for P as P equal to pi times B minus 1 minus pi times R over B minus R. And that gives you a word of caution why B and R have to be different. B refers to the number of black cards, R refers to the number of red cards in the game that the investigator is, that the respondent is playing based on B plus R cards. So based on a sample of N respondents, we obtain what is the proportion of yes responses. That gives us an estimate of pi. Pi hat is the proportion of yes count in the RRT method, and hence we can solve P hat from the above equation. So let's try to understand. Pi is the proportion of yes responses in the population. That pi hat is nothing but the proportion of yes count in the RRT method. And then that pi is related to P and 1 minus P through this equation. And thereby we get an expression for P in terms of pi. So the moment I have an estimate of pi from the sample proportion of yes count, I can estimate P through this equation. It is a routine exercise to establish that P hat is unbiased, and also that it is straightforward to compute variance of P hat and work out V hat P hat. That's because P is related to pi through a linear equation. So I can obtain, using the binomial sampling results, I know what is pi hat, I know what is variance of pi hat, V hat pi hat. I can use that to obtain estimate of P and the variance of P and P hat, P hat. These are all routine exercises.
Sir, let us take up an example for the sake of understanding the computations. Let capital N be 100, small n be 30, B also 30, and R 20. Number of yes responses in the RRT is 15. Then pi hat is 15 upon 30, which is half. And hence p hat is also half. Further, v hat y pi hat is equal to 1 divided by n minus 1 divided by n, whole multiplied by small n, times pi hat multiplied by 1 minus pi hat divided by n minus 1, which is approximately 0.0625. Therefore, v hat p hat is equal to v hat pi hat times b plus r divided by b minus r whole squared, which is 0.156 approximately. Is that all?
Yes, so when we refer to the formula, we know how pi and p are related. So once we know my pi hat, we can get p hat. That's all you are doing by incorporating the values of b and r. And similarly, when I know v hat pi hat, we are using the same relation to find out v hat, p hat. So these are straightforward computations that you did. But then, this is just the beginning of a whole lot of results that follow from queries posed before a survey statistician. The modes of conducting the RRT have been varied. This was the simplest mode of application of RRT. It's called the related question method. Let's see what is there. Mainly from the point of view of maintaining highest level of confidentiality and gaining increasing level of confidence from the respondents, different methods have been suggested. So it is a vast and varied method of extracting information, valid information, from the respondents by giving them full highest level of confidentiality and gaining their full level confidence. I won't get into any of these details. Instead, I refer to a book by Professor Arijit Chaudhary and Professor Rahul Mukherjee. Their book came out in 1988. The book is Randomized Response Theory and Methods, Musselbecker. This RRT technique is also made available when you want to estimate the finite population total corresponding to a stigmatizing quantitative study character, capital Y, such as, for example, your extra income beyond your regular job. If there is any extra income, what is the sum total estimated income of a adult population in a locality in case they have some extra income beyond the regular job, something like gambling, this, that, etc., something that is coming not directly related to the main profession of the individual. So for that kind of thing also, we can apply this kind of technique to make sure that they give truthful response, maintaining and supposedly they believe that their confidentiality has been protected. So there are many techniques like this. Reference is also made to a graduate level textbook. As I said, I have a book with Professor Hidayat from the University of Illinois at Chicago. This book was published in 1999. In that book, we have a big chapter on this RRT technique. So we'll stop now and we'll take up some questions and comments. In this module, we introduced a non-trivial technique for eliciting information from the respondents. The situation is like this, that we have got a sensitive character, be it qualitative or quantitative, kind of stigmatizing character, where direct response technique is not available, nor recommended, nor advisable, because the respondent apprehends that his or her privacy is being questioned. Therefore, in such situations, there is a technique called randomized response technique, suggested long time back in 1965, and then that technique has been tremendously popular. And in this module, we are having a test of the technique that has been suggested in its simplest form. That is what we took up. Now we will go ahead and take up some questions and exercises underlying this technique. There may be something more coming up in this context as you look to the exercises. Yeah, let me read the question number one. It is desired to estimate the percentage of smokers. among college students in a certain neighborhood. Towards this, all 68 students are identified, and independently as well as individually, they were presented with the same RRT scheme involving a total of 40 ordinary playing cards with the composition 25 black and 15 red. The black cards carried the question at the back, "Are you a smoker?" Similarly, the red cards carried the question at the back, "Are you a non-smoker?" In either case, the response sort is very simple, yes or no. Each student picks up a card at random. Accordingly, depending on the question that is written at the back of the card, provides a truthful response. Suppose altogether there are 32 yes answers from the two sets combined. Suggest an unbiased estimator for capital P and also provide an estimated variance estimate. Let's read again. Each student picks up a card at random and accordingly provides a truthful response. If the student says yes, there is a double standard in the response yes. It could be arising out of the black card. In that case, the individual is, of course, is indeed a smoker, and it could be coming from a red card. In that case, the respondent is a non-smoker. So we have to see how the yes and no questions are to be interpreted. And suppose on the whole, we got altogether 32 yes answers from the two sets combined, means from black and red cards combined. You have to suggest an unbiased estimate for P and provide an estimated variance estimate. You just carefully see the formulation that has been given in the text, the defining relation that has come, combining the percentage of yes response in the population and the percentage of smokers in the population. And combining these two, there is a defining equation. In terms of capital B and capital R, capital B is the number of black cards, in this example 25. Capital R is the number of red cards, in this example 15. So you have to sort out the formula and then get it. The question number 2 says, in question number 1, suppose the red cards carried the question, "Were you born in the first quarter of a year?" We are going to take up some variations of the basic method suggested by Warner in these questions. So question number 2 is the first type of variation in Warner's original question. Or Warner's questions were, as you know, referring to the black card, "Are you a smoker?" referring to the red card, "Are you a non-smoker?" Because they relate to the same thing, those are called related questions method. Whereas in question 2, we are saying the red cards, they carry an entirely different question, "Are you born in the first quarter of a year?" There again the answer will be yes or no. And as to the question of whether you are a smoker or not, the answer is again yes or no. But this question is not related to the question involving smoker. These are called unrelated questions method. Still you are referring to two sets of cards, black and red. Black has at the back, "Are you a smoker?" On the other hand, red has at the back, "Are you born in the first quarter of the year?" And again, altogether, imagine there are 32 yes answers from the two sets combined. Now can you provide an answer to the question raised above? What question means? Estimating capital P, the proportion of smokers, and then getting a variance estimate. It's a good question. Let's read question number 3. In question number 1, suppose the red cards carried the question, "Are you fond of watching James Bond movies?" And this time, suppose it is known that there are 55% college students fond of James Bond movies. This information is known. What percentage of college students they like James Bond movies? That information you have. And again, altogether, there are 32 yes answers from the two sets combined. Can you provide an answer to the question of estimation of capital P? There is another question here. In the setup of question 1, the question inserted at the back of the red cards is the same as that described in question 3. That means the James Bond movie, liking for James Bond movie. However, the percentage of James Bond movie fans among the college students is not accurately known. The set of 40 cards is now decomposed into two subsets. One is subset 1, 15 black, 10 red, that gives you a total of 25, and subset 2, 10 black and 5 red, that gives you a total of 15. You already started with 40 cards, there are 25 black and 15 red. You decompose those 40 cards into two sets, subset 1 and subset 2. All the 40 students, you randomly, they are asked, they are selected and asked to provide answer to the RRT scheme based on the subset number 1. And their responses are 26 yes and 14 no. From the remaining students following the subset 2, the responses are 20 yes and 8 no. Analyze the data and provide answers to the questions raised above with respect to question 1. So let's see once again. Looks like there are altogether 40 plus 20 plus 8. There are altogether 68 students. So those 68 students are again randomly divided into 40 and 28. 40 students, they are given the subset number 1, that means 15 black and 10 red cards, and they are subject to the same type of question, the same type of RRT procedure. And out of those 40, eventually the response is 26 yes and 14 no. The remaining 28 students, they are exposed to subset 2, where the black and red cards are like 10 and 15. And of those 28 students, 20 said yes and 8 said no. Analyze the data and provide answers to the questions raised above with respect to question 1. That means estimating P, percentage of the smokers, and then its estimate and variance estimate, etc. These are tricky questions. These are not difficult, and one can see why you need to have two subsets. In all the previous questions, you are introducing an unrelated question, like, are you born in the first quarter of a year, or do you like James Bond movies? But in those, you already had additional information regarding the percentage of the character that you are introducing. For example, you know that if you are talking about a random sample of students, and if you are referring to the first quarter of a year, then roughly one third is the proportion of students born in the first quarter. That is the kind of thing. And also in the other question, percentage of James Bond movie like, the fans who like, that percentage are already given. So in that you know, but in question 4, you are saying that you are reading the question of liking or not liking the James Bond movies, but you don't know what percent of students they like it. Therefore, you are introducing another parameter. So on the top of the parameter P, which refers to the proportion of smokers, you are introducing another parameter, call it P star, which refers to the proportion of James Bond movie lovers, fans. Because there are two unknowns, you need two equations to solve, and subset 1 and subset 2, they precisely give you the two equations. So once you write down the two equations, you can solve for both the parameters, but your particular interest is in the proportion of smokers, that is your primary parameter, and that you can estimate from this data. Let's see what are the, well, I think that's all, yeah. In this special topic, I did not keep any MCQ, because I thought these are good enough for you to have an understanding and to go ahead slowly with further reading. As I said, this book by Hidayat and Sinha, one very big chapter devoted, also this book by Chaudhary and Mukherjee that is exclusively on RRT technique. And there are many, many variations of this technique. Here I only told about the related question and unrelated question.